Hello, my name is Mark Etling. I'm a member of the affiliate faculty at the School for Professional Studies at St. Louis University. Today I'd like to discuss the teaching on property as it's found in Pope Paul VI's encyclical, Populorum Progressio. One of the most basic tenets of the Christian faith is that the world and all that is in it have been created by God. The material world is considered good in itself, based on the repeated affirmations by God of its goodness in the first chapter of Genesis. The Christian tradition further holds that the human person has a special place in the plan of God's creation. Each and every person possesses infinite dignity and worth because she or he is created in the very image of God. And human dignity makes each person the subject of innate human rights. One of these is the right to an amount of material goods sufficient to sustain life and to fulfill oneself as a person. At the same time, humanity is charged with the responsibility for the well-being of all, because we are created in the image of the Trinity, a society of three divine persons whose love is by nature other-centered. Material goods, therefore, have been given by God to humanity for two fundamental reasons. First, for the satisfaction of basic needs and the fulfillment of personality. Second, for the establishment of a social order built on love and human solidarity, whose crowning achievement is peace. The encyclical Populorum Progressio, issued by Pope Paul VI on March 26, 1967, is a continuation of the modern Catholic social teaching tradition initiated by Pope Leo XIII in 1891 with his encyclical Rerum Novarum. Populorum Progressio is considered a landmark document in the teaching on the social question for two reasons. First, Paul VI restated clearly and emphatically the Catholic Church's centuries-old traditional teaching on the ownership and use of property. Second, the Pope creatively and dramatically expanded the application of the property teaching in light of the prevailing economic and social circumstances of his times. In this brief lecture, I will discuss how Paul VI accomplished these two ends. The property teaching of Populorum Progressio is best understood in light of its anthropology, the creation of the human person in the image of God, the Imago Dei, the dignity, rights, and social duties that flowed therefrom, the equality of all persons, and the right of each person to participate in his or her own development. The most noteworthy aspect of the property teaching in the encyclical is its forceful emphasis on the social function of material goods in God's plan of creation. Using the traditional property teaching of Thomas Aquinas, Paul VI placed a timely emphasis on the social function of property. In line with Aquinas' teaching, Populorum Progressio asserted that the use of material goods is a fundamental primary right, and that the right of ownership is secondary and derived. The right of ownership is secured by jus gentium, or positive common law, while the right of use follows directly from the natural law. Ownership exists so that a social order can be established in which the right of usage is assured. Therefore, ownership is understood merely as the means to an end. As Peter Riga wrote in his book, The Church of the Poor, quote, "The right to property exists so that the right of usage may be assured and guaranteed." The heart of the property teaching in Populorum Progressio is found in Numbers 22 through 24, entitled The Universal Purpose of Created Things. The encyclical developed and expanded upon the property teaching in Vatican Council II's Gaudium et Spes, which in Number 69 had declared that, quote, "created goods should abound for all people on a reasonable basis." This principle was founded on the traditional teaching which states that the world exists for the livelihood and growth of all persons, that created things are intended by use for all people. All other property rights, such as the right of ownership, freedom of commerce, and the right of nationhood, are subordinated to the right of all to use the good things of the earth. Number 23 of Populorum Progressio restates in unambiguous terms the traditional teaching on the primacy of the social function of material goods. Quote, private property does not constitute for anyone an absolute and unconditional right. No one is justified in keeping for his exclusive use what he does not need when others lack necessities. Property ownership is seen as primarily a social responsibility. Absolute ownership, defined as the right to own, control, and dispose of as much property as one can, is considered, as Peter Riga wrote, quote, a grave social aberration. Here, Populorum Progressio represents a complete reversal of the position of Leo XIII in Rerum Novarum. Leo XIII had declared ownership to be a natural right, or a right inherent in human nature, rather than a derivative right, in such a way that implied absolute discretion over the disposition of property. Paul VI broke new ground in Populorum Progressio in that he framed the teaching on the priority of the social function of property in the context of the call to worldwide development and solidarity. No previous social document had drawn such a sweeping and dramatic conclusion from this aspect of the traditional property teaching. The obvious implication of this principle is the need for a more equitable distribution of goods worldwide. The Dominican Louis Le Bray, one of the theologians who influenced Paul VI's social teaching, had previously made this point in his book, Human Ascent, quote, only a balance in the distribution of material and spiritual goods, only a balance between needs and resources will assure world peace by cooperation in justice. Populorum Progressio maintains that the ownership of material goods makes one responsible for their proper distribution, based on the needs of all, especially the poor of the world, in the context of the universal common good. This is because the earth has been given by God to all persons for our use as incarnate beings. The understanding of the human person as social by nature and the awareness of the international scope of the social question in general led Paul VI to broaden the definition of property in Populorum Progressio. For the first time in the social teaching, the property of nations, raw materials, exports, and agricultural products were considered forms of property. The internationalization of the definition of property would expand even more in Paul VI's later social documents. Paul VI did consider property ownership to be a legitimate end of development, and material goods were not seen as evil in themselves. In Populorum Progressio, he makes a plea for a modicum of goods for all. Lack of material possessions is listed as one of the less human conditions which development should alleviate, and possession of material goods is one of the more human conditions that leads to integral or holistic development. But at the same time, Paul VI considered property to be fraught with temptation to the sins of avarice, greed, and materialism. Therefore, in number 19, he states, quote, increased possession is not the ultimate goal of nations nor of individuals. Rather, possessions are to be understood as an opportunity to promote the more human aims of fulfillment and solidarity. Populorum Progressio views ownership as ambivalent. It helps persons develop as persons, but it also imprisons them if they make possession the supreme good. Paul VI reaffirmed this aspect of the property teaching in his address on the first anniversary of Populorum Progressio on March 27, 1968, when he stated that religion reminds, quote, the rich man that he is an administrator and not the despotic master of his possessions, whose fruits should be in some fair measure at the service of the needy. The encyclical went on to say that nations have a duty to secure for their own people a level of ownership that will satisfy their basic needs, secure their freedom in society, and promote civil peace. This requires, and at times even demands, strong measures. In some parts of the world, expropriation may be the only way to secure a just distribution of land. But expropriation, as Benjamin Massey pointed out, was not to be taken as a condemnation of ownership itself, only the abuse of ownership. Because land that is not used to promote the common good violates the social function of property. The encyclical points out in number 24 that measures may also be taken to prevent wealthy citizens from taking their wealth out of their home country and investing it in other countries. In this context, Populorum Progressio raises the possibility of violent revolution in order to achieve a just distribution of property. Paul VI's position on revolution in Populorum Progressio was new to the social teaching. In 1963, in Pacem in Terris, Pope John XXIII had espoused the strategy of gradualism. He wrote, quote, "It must be borne in mind that to proceed gradually is the law of life in all its expressions. Therefore, in human institutions too, it is not possible to renovate for the better, except by working from within." Paul VI stopped well short of advocating violent revolution, and Populorum Progressio espouses in number 64 a consensus model for social change. But he warned, as Peter Riga pointed out, that without massive aid for development from rich countries, revolution might break out all over the world. Populorum Progressio also takes up the issue of the international common good. In number 49, it states that the superfluous wealth of rich countries, in other words, that which remains after basic needs are satisfied, should be used to help the poor countries. The property of any one nation should be subordinated to the worldwide common good. But the transfer of wealth from the rich to the poor nations should not be done in a paternalistic or condescending fashion. Rather, there should be respect for the self-determination of the poor nations. The encyclical suggests some specific ways that property and wealth might be more evenly distributed worldwide. It calls for the establishment of a world fund, for a tax on luxury items, and for a progressive income tax to help redistribute wealth. The inevitable conflicts that would occur as a result of the clash between property ownership and the common good even led Paul VI to call for the establishment of a worldwide political authority to plan for the just distribution of the world's goods. Populorum Progressio is a landmark document of the Catholic Church's social teaching, and one of the main reasons why is its property teaching. Paul VI took the traditional Catholic teaching on property and applied it in some dramatic and progressive ways. In terms of the priority of the social function of property over private ownership, the definition of property, the disposition of superfluous wealth, the framing of the property question in terms of the overall development of nations, and the call for a just distribution of goods worldwide. Clearly, its principles are as timely today as they were when it was issued over 40 years ago. Thank you very much for listening. I hope we can continue the conversation on this important topic. I wish you peace.